Welcome back to the Crooked Spine Show. Today's talk is with Dr. Doug, who runs a nonprofit called Samaritan Counseling Center that serves Upland and surrounding communities. He has helped recently families, individuals, even children deal with the COVID crisis of 2020. In our talk, we talk about what he has discussed with his clients, what has been the major topics that helped them cope and get back to both physical and mental health. Our topics today include anger stress management, including PTSD, also to dealing with a loss of a job, loss of a family member, or loss of the overall routine or lifestyle. Talk about too is finding a plan B or a plan C routine, because right now plan A is not working. Also, we talk about too is what is quarantine and isolation stress and how to heal from that and cope with your current condition. And Dr. Doug is a big proponent of something called resilience. We talk about that at the 54th minute. Resilience, what that means right now in these times. We also talk about too is how a trainer, a coach, or a therapist, especially mental therapist, can help you avoid the risk of going on your own to get yourself healthy. We also talk about too is perception of reality and what that is now versus perception versus what is actually spoke about in the media or people around you. We finish up the talk with too about how we grow through stress and how it's important to understand good stress, grow ourselves again physically and mentally. And Dr. Doug basically wraps it up about the 127th minute of this overall talk. Again, a longer talk, but worthwhile to understand how to cope with these current COVID times. All right, so hope you enjoyed the talk. Again, the show notes has highlights of the actual talk. Dr. Doug's contact, Samaritan Counseling Center in Upland. Now, enjoy the talk, and I'll wrap it up afterwards. So,
my guest today is Dr. Doug, we call him, the executor of Samaritan Counseling Center in Upland also. He is an expert in the sense where not only does he see patients, but also runs a clinic and actually has the experience of other doctors in the clinic too that can pull information from. In these crazy times with COVID-19, the last couple months or so, I wanted Dr. Doug on because I want him to explain how do we get through this mentally so we don't kill my spouse, my dog, cause injuries or murders to people, okay? As we know through this process too, there is a high, right now, a higher amount of domestic violence, alcoholism, and things related to that because we've been kind of shut in. Dr. Doug, kind of walk through a quick bio of you when you started being a psychologist and how that started for you. How do you want to get into this?
Wow, big question.
Give me a small answer though. Don't go too crazy. Don't feel like 5 hours on it.
Gosh. You said we had 5 hours, you said?
No, I said don't spend 5 hours on your answer. Let me make sure.
So, you know, I got into this a number of years ago. I've been working as a therapist of some sort for, gosh, over 26 years now. Bottom line is I got into it because I wanted to help others. I started off in mechanical engineering and I could do it, but it didn't, you know, didn't flip my switch.
Wasn't your vocation? Yeah.
Say it again?
Wasn't your vocation, right?
Nope. I needed something, you know, if I'm going to throw myself into it, it's something I had to, get up. It has to get me up in the morning. So helping others is where that started. And it grew ever since. Got a couple of master's degrees and a doctorate. And that way I can practice independently. I could run a clinic. And multiply myself by, you know, supervising others that can help even more people. So I'm thrilled to be able to do this and help a lot of people in the process. It's a humbling process, knowing that you're creating a sacred space, if you will, a safe place for people to deal with tough issues, and you are helping transform lives. Literally saving lives. So whether that's children, adults, families, helping them through some of the toughest times, or just helping them grow in their lives so they can thrive. So a person doesn't have to be really down and out to come in for therapy and get help and be able to grow and and thrive. So,
well, a lot of is your volume on your phone up or down? I'm okay. We're good. Sounds good.
Yeah, we're good. It's if I need to, I can put in a headset.
No worries.
Sometimes it's hard to hear.
But I think a lot of it is when we talk about mental health, it's not, like you said, it's not someone that's in the sanitarium. It's not someone that can't function daily life. Can all of us improve our mental health, our attitude per se, also about our environment, our life stressors, if you can deal with it in a proper way? And I think something you do is you allow people to know what that proper way is and get through their struggles, because all our lives are changing every day, correct? I mean, we're all going through some type of stressor, but how it affects us mentally and from there physically, it can be dealt with in a healthy manner versus sometimes covered up with drugs or with alcohol or with violence for one too.
We turn to a variety of things when we're feeling stressed, mm-hmm. or out of control, or what we're hoping for in life is not what we're experiencing. And so we all have coping mechanisms.
Yes.
Some of them are healthy and some of them are actually detrimental. So I think that's part of what you're alluding to. Gosh, there's a whole bunch of things that we can do to help ourselves. And it makes all the difference in the world, the choices that we make. So,
yeah. How do we go from a first topic we talked about earlier, is how do we deal with anger management?
How do we deal with anger management?
Right now with domestic violence being on the rise because of being stuck at home and not moving, not being able to do their normal routine, maybe work, taking care of kids at home now, so that them being in school, from a parent perspective to start, or a spouse perspective, whichever way you want to go, how do we start dealing with that and even becoming aware that we have a problem?
So I think it's a little tricky. I'm gonna answer your question, but in a perhaps a circuitous way.
I don't know what that means.
Anger is actually a secondary emotion.
Yeah, okay.
So we have to look at what's below that. And so it could be a tremendous hurt. Mm. And so what is the person doing to address that? Those are the things that I would look at. There's, you know, if we talk about what do we do in the acute phase of anger? Well, you know, there's some good coping skills for that. You can count backwards from 10 and you know, take a time out and chill, think about something more positive. So, I mean, there's some acute phases of that, and those are all good and well. But what I would want to do is, all right, let's take a look at what are the underlying issues? What are the things that are driving that are not being addressed, so that the anger, whether it's expressed, anger towards ourselves, there's a variety of ways that can come out, or towards others. So, you know, you might see it manifest in depression, anxiety, violence, acting out, or like you said, domestic violence, lashing out at one's kids. We work with a lot of kids that have been abused and neglected. It's the stories that, you know, that are that we are confronted with, people's lives that we're confronted with, it's tremendously sad, and yet we know we can make a difference. So going back to your question of anger, what can a person do? First of all, is get in touch with what's going on inside them, because if they're hurt, they're frustrated, whether it's a current relationship or right now, I mean, we're faced with COVID-19. We're faced with record unemployment. We're faced with all kinds of stressors that people can have a really tough time dealing with. So, if you take an average person, typical person who has a job, they have a routine in life. Things are, you know, the way I look at it is, if you, where's the screen? If this is the amount of resources you have, and this is the typical stressors, then you have enough resources to meet those stressors. I'm keeping it simple, man. Do you like my graph? But if it feels like, if it's a perception or a felt or a realistic notion that the stressors have now overrun the resources, then you have a situation where it's untenable. You cannot sustain that over a course of time. And that's going to come out in different ways. So as males, a typical emotional reaction secondary to that felt hurt, helplessness, whatever, is anger. You know, so there's different emotions that come out. But since you're asking about anger, looking at some of the root causes, some of it might be a felt out of control. So in COVID-19, we have a loss of routine. We're not being able to gather with some of our buddies, our biking group, our gym, our church, family, community gatherings. We're involved with a lot of chamber events. You know, I love interacting with folks, and that gives life, right? Some people have lost their job. Some people have a feared loss of their job and their health insurance. And then even a feared loss of their health. They're not able to go to their favorite restaurants. They have to, wear these masks or stay 6 feet apart. My gosh, how many times I've heard people having to do distance learning for their kids.
Yeah.
Okay, so just that alone, you have a level of frustration. It's like, okay, I got to work. I got to take care of this. I got to take care of all these things in the house. And now I have to do distance learning with my kids and teach them this stuff that I haven't even looked at. And I don't know how to do this crap, you know? So the frustration level, the sense of things out of control, that I don't have any choice in this, builds. And that can lead to reactions.
How do you know your body's going through that? So how do you become aware of, okay, I'm going through this, And now I'm outward reacting to it, maybe on my spouse or my kids. How do you make sure you're aware of that?
That's a great question.
I try.
Yeah. It's a both and. Hopefully we have people that care about us well enough to say something. Okay. One thing that we might do, if you look at the research, one of the biggest things that folks do is isolate.
Okay.
So that's not a physical thing, but that is a behavioral thing. So when we talk about this, we're talking physical, behavioral, thought patterns. So if you find yourself isolating, if you find yourself having trouble with sleeping, so it depends. Some people sleep more, some people sleep less. Some people wake up and they don't feel rested. Some people have a nagging tension in their body. I know when I'm stressed, I carry it up in my shoulders. Sometimes if it's bad enough, if I don't get my sleep, and you know, I can get a headache. So if you multiply that day after day, some of that is just normal dealing with crap in life, right? But if you multiply that day after day, that builds up. Well, you could take a perfectly sane person, if you will, deprive them of sleep, and bad stuff happens. They can't think as clearly. They're much more emotionally reactive. And so those are some of the examples. So physically, those are some examples. Also, again, behaviorally, maybe eating, overeating, emotional eating. Mm-hmm. Maybe they cut back on food. So again, when I'm talking about these things, there's nothing wrong with cutting back on food. Some people need to do that. Maybe they're cutting back on food, but they're eating primarily junk food or things that aren't, you know,
that makes you feel better versus that's good for you.
Yeah. That's
a lot of, when we're in a routine of, okay, I'm going to work at 8 in the morning, even at 5, I have to make sure I bring enough my lunch, make sure I have enough food for dinner and at night. So things are planned out. When things are sometimes not planned out, you're running the cabinet. Oh, I have this today in my cabinet. I can eat this today. I can do whatever I want to do, like you're on vacation. Problem is vacation sometimes lasts the Saturday, Sunday, not for 3 months.
Yeah.
So you see the results on your body of now more lethargic, like you said, more tension, more things like that. Do people have usually their unique sign of, for example, neck tension when they're stressed, where they don't sleep well, where they eat certain foods, where they just get grouchy? People have like a unique way that they show stress on their body?
I would say yes. Most of us have some telltale signs that we are under stress or something's really bugging us. You know, like I said, for myself, if something is really stressing me out, it will affect my sleep. Mm. That's a very common thing. I gave you the example of emotional eating. Some people are emotional eaters. So if they're not being intentional, I like to use the word intentional on this. If we are more intentional about the choices that we make, then we have a greater ability to do something about it.
How do you communicate that to, for example, a spouse or a child? Hey, look, I'm having a rough day. I'm having headaches. I didn't sleep very well last night. Let me do this, this, and this to get myself back on track.
What you said, yes.
Okay. Is it good, and I guess I kind of answer my question, is it good to communicate that to people around you in your own home to make sure it doesn't escalate, it kind of decelerates because they'll know where you are that day and from yeah. mental and physical state?
I think it's essential. I go back to research. In fact, go back in time, Dr. Donald Meichenbaum did a lot of research, and he looked at folks that been in wartime, you know, soldiers returning, and you think about the trauma that they've gone through. So I'm going to an extreme here to demonstrate that some of these points. He studied it, and what he found was individuals, and these are individuals that have gone through some type of trauma. So actually, I'm gonna turn something back to over to you real quick, and I want to ask you a question.
Oh,
of all these folks, these soldiers, let's just pick on the military returning from, and these are not just folks that have been in a supportive role, but have actually gone through some type of traumatic situation. What percentage, and you probably know the answer, what percentage of those folks develop post-traumatic stress disorder?
I'm gonna say in my head, 40%.
Here's the interesting thing you found is 25%, about 25% did. So then here's what we need to be curious about is, what was it about the 75% that they did not develop PTSD?
Okay.
Interesting, huh?
Yeah.
Because they could come up with they identified things of the 25% of what they did that developed the PTSD, exacerbated it, and I'm in again a circuitous fashion a bit, but in your question of sharing what's going on for you in your immediate family or those around you, that's what you're getting at. What they found was in the 25%, they didn't share with others. They didn't talk about it. They didn't deal with it.
Okay.
So that's just one of the big things that they found, you know, and these are extremes, right?
Yep.
Not that many people go through that level of trauma. But let's boil it down to the typical person. The same exact thing applies.
Yeah.
If we're not able to articulate what's going on for us, or like for myself, I might have a, you know, just intense day, week, or whatever, and I'll tell my wife, it's like, I need some extra grace right now, because you know, blankety blank, this crap happened, and I just need some extra grace. Mm-hmm. So that's an example of saying, thus and such happened. I'm feeling stressed out. I'm asking for some extra grace, some extra leeway, because I might be a little snappy. I might be on edge a bit, and I'm asking for some patience. That doesn't mean I'm going to disrespect or something like that. It just my initial reaction might go, and so I'm going to work hard at not doing that. But I'm sharing with you, this is what's going on.
And do guys versus girls, do they communicate that differently or a certain amount? For example, with guys, do most guys have problems doing that versus women, say, are more at ease doing that, communicating?
That's the easy answer to that question is guys have a more difficult time.
Okay.
So I could answer it that way.
And should women... wives, for example, give more grace because they may not communicate it as well?
Well,
I'm hoping here, Kevin.
That's a loaded question there, my friend. And I want to go back to your first question, though, about guys versus gals, because yes, women tend to be more verbal about it, but the way they do that can make all the difference in the world, too.
Okay.
So... just because they're more verbal, that doesn't mean it's a healthy way of doing it. Mm. And with guys, that the quietness, just because they're quiet, that does not mean it's healthy. So I'm putting caveats on those. Would we want our spouse to be understanding? Of course we would. And I think in marriages, as we get to know each other, you can sense some of that. That does not replace communication, though.
Yeah.
I work with lots of couples, and one of the things, probably the biggest thing that trips folks up in relationships is communication. Okay. So we all want some grace. And so part of what you're saying, I think, is practicing understanding and grace. So we want that, we hope for that from our spouse, and we also need to use adequate communication, because as I like to tell my clients, I'm really good at what I do, but I don't read minds.
Yeah.
Right?
Well, you could guess, but if you guess wrong, that can make the situation work versus better.
Yeah, and if you're constantly having to guess, is that helping your spouse?
No.
No.
It's exciting in a negative way, but yeah.
I like how you put that. It's exciting in a negative way.
Yeah.
You're a risk taker, and you will like to.
Exactly. I like the couch. The couch is comfortable sometimes.
Yeah. Okay with that.
and kind of a carry on from that too. How can you miscommunicate your emotions to where it can be taken the wrong way? Don't mean to rephrase that, or
sure.
Do some people, if you want to call it, become dramatic about their situation or what they're feeling, where it can turn off the other person?
If I'm understand what you're saying, it. There's some folks that, you might have this in a relationship where they're upset, and the person themselves, they don't fully realize what's at the deeper level, what they're upset by.
Got it. Okay. So
that's a common, I would say that's a, well, it's not uncommon for an individual to be frustrated and maybe expressing emotionally and maybe even lashing out at the, I mean, the reality is we lash out at whoever's around us, which happens to be typically the people closest to us, right?
Dang it.
Yeah, darn. So that's just life. And so what can we do about that? It's trying to pause and take a breath and reflect on maybe what's driving that pain, is driving that stuff, lashing out. Part of the reason why that's so difficult is because that requires a greater level of vulnerability.
Yeah.
And I would argue that oftentimes that's why it's even more difficult for men in general to do that, because we don't like to be vulnerable.
Oh. You should be, but yeah.
Well, there's lots of shoulds, but again, I go back to the word being intentional. If we choose to say, I'm really frustrated about thus and such, or I feel upset when you interrupt me, or I feel disrespected when you completely talk over me and do thus and such, whatever.
Yeah.
That's a more constructive way of dealing with it than to just react back and call the person names or whatever.
Or talk louder.
Well, sometimes, no. So going back to your question, there's a variety of ways people emotionally act out or emotionally, sometimes it comes out as, I call it like verbal vomit.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Very unpleasant to have verbal vomit on you.
Yeah.
So then it's, okay, what is going on underneath such that all this stuff is going on? It's not uncommon for the person, like I said, to not know what is driving underneath. And that can be, again, that's a very, that's why therapy can be very useful, because they could be, that could be coming out on at their spouse, their kids, the people, their friends. And if they're not aware of what's driving that, what's underneath that, then that has the potential of continuing on, and therapy can be very, very useful at addressing that. Again, this can be a very functional person.
People just stop communicating completely because it's not positive at all. Correct.
Some people do that. Yeah.
Yeah. It almost makes people more distant than beneficial, especially if you're at home with each other all the time.
You have couples that, in order to quote unquote keep the peace,
mm-hmm.
they just stop talking with each other. Stop. Yeah. And again, that doesn't solve the problem.
That's not very exciting at all. No, not fun. Next topic from those we talked about is, how do you deal with a loss? And right now, being like you mentioned, the plane being so high, how do you deal with a loss of a job or furlough or reduced hours where you said you may not have a job to go back to?
Do you have any easy questions?
No, not at all. We got your name out of the way. That was an easy question. Got that one out of the way.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah. Thank you for that. Honestly, we're in a tough time.
Mm-hmm.
We're in a really tough time. Loss, I rattled off a bunch of losses or things that we're contending with right now, right? And it could be a perceived loss, a loss that we're worried about occurring, and or an actual loss, like the job is already lost. Okay. Yeah. Or it could be that we've lost our hour, you know, the person's lost hours in their job, but they believe that, you know, they can get it back. When, as humans, when we feel out of control, that is a very, it's in a nice way, it's a very uncomfortable situation.
Yeah.
When we feel out of control, we tend to want to find ways of controlling it. And, you know, whether you go back to the research on trauma that I mentioned earlier, or resilience, I think resilience is something I want to comment on in regards to that. We want to control, and when we feel out of control, we sometimes we make choices where we feel like we have some control. So sometimes, this sounds like it's an oxymoron, but because you think of control, but then people do eating.
Yeah.
And then they eat out of control, or they drink, or use some kind of substance out of control, or they, you know, fill in the blank. There's a lot of different things that we turn to as a way of coping, to fill that pain, to fill that void. And those are detrimental. So if those are detrimental, then what are things that we can do? There's a whole host of things. If we look at COVID-19 and how we're responding to it, there's things that we can control, and there's things that we can't control. In fact, that reminds me of the serenity prayer. God, grant me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change, courage to change the things I can, and the wisdom to know the difference.
You memorized that thing, didn't you?
I've known it for many years. I've practiced that, and I've encouraged clients with that. And it's quite powerful, because the wisdom to know the difference. See, if we are trying to control something that we ultimately can't control, like I can't control, I cannot make this virus go away.
Yeah.
So I could want to do that, and that would be an exercise of futility. And yeah. I'm spending a lot of energy on something that I could be really upset with, you know, I'm not going to get political here, but fill in the blank. There's a lot of blank, you know, blanks that we can fill in there. So it's no matter your political stripe, it's getting upset with that, you know, whatever that is, as if they're going to be our savior and take care of us, right?
Yeah.
So then we go back to, okay, God, help me to do, in other words, to focus on the things that I can do. What can I do in this situation? So that person who has lost their job, what can they do? That person who is uncertain of their future, what can they do? That is part of what I would go back to. And each person's situation is going to be different. So I can't answer that question without having an actual person in front of me. What I can do is say, all right, well, if we put some, if we look at it from, let's say, from a point of resiliency.
Yeah.
First off, I would say there's a number of items, and depending on what there's all kinds of research on resiliency, and they might say here's the five things that, you know, that you can do to build resiliency, or the six or seven, whatever. I can give you a number of things that will help with that. So in the midst of COVID-19, if if you're not working. And one extent or another, we've all faced this, just having some structure in our day, right? We've had people going, what day is it?
Yeah. Exactly.
But our brains need structure. So if a person's not working right now, okay, what are we doing to structure our day? What are we doing to structure our life? I would say also related to that is purpose and meaning in life. What are we doing that gives us purpose? Okay, so you're not doing thus and such job. Okay, then what can one do?
There you go.
What can one do? So Governor Newsom says, you can't do X, Y, and Z. All right, well, what can I do, right? That's the first thing I went to is, what can I do? What can we do?
Yeah.
When we connect with others and when we support or encourage others, That can provide meaning and purpose in life. That's a way of sometimes, you know, going back to a job situation, sometimes we get jobs. Sometimes there are jobs that are at the ready. And, you know, I say, hey, Dr. Tony, gosh, I'm looking for such and such. And you might know someone who's looking for that. So that's, I'm connecting those two things. But in terms of resilience, connection with others is essential. So if we're going through a really difficult time, seeking out others as opposed to isolating. If you look at the 25% that developed post-traumatic stress disorder, they isolated. Mm. They avoided. So do the opposite. What are the 75%? They actually had post-traumatic growth as opposed to being stuck or triggered by all kinds of things. That doesn't mean that there aren't scars, but when we as humans, we tend to grow through, or at least we have the opportunity to grow through adversity.
Well, I think a lot of it when you talked about the Samaritan prayer is you're not, if my energy level, if I have 100 points of energy every day to use, can I use 90% on what I can control versus if I use 90% on what I can't control, now I have nothing to be productive with. So like you had mentioned, finding a routine, finding something that drives purpose in whatever times you're in, and then connecting people around you, that socialization, that's a healthy, and again, hopefully around positive people, that's a healthy way to keep your mind and body at a certain amount so we don't lose ourselves in the day watching the news or doing things that just won't really be productive for our own physical or mental health.
I love how you equated it to, like, okay, so if we only have 100, and that gets back to what I say in terms of resources, it's in a similar fashion. So if we only have a 100 chips of energy to expend, what are we going to expend it on? Mm-hmm. I love that because we could, that's part of the problem. Weeks ago, you had mentioned, hey, what are some warning signs to look out for with in terms of depression, anxiety, and how that might manifest. If a person has, let's just say, like 100 chips of energy in a day, part of the problem with anxiety is that you're spending a lot of chips on the rumination, on the anxious thing, and you have little energy left to go do something productive.
Yeah.
If you repeat that whole cycle over and over again, this is why, and these are broad brushstrokes.
Yep.
That's where you can often see that anxiety turn into depression. These are they're very much related. If you're overextending and burning out yourself that way, you can sink into exhaustion, if you will. So
how do you break that cycle? Or if that's your routine, your habit, your daily habit per se, how long does it take to change into a better state, mental state of health?
You know, there's various arguments on that. I would say it takes some time to establish a a routine.
Okay.
But first you have to make a decision. So some researchers came up with a whole decision wheel. I won't go into it's like the De Clement, Prochaska. Anyway, it has to do with motivation and movement towards change, right? So if today I decide I'm going to establish a new routine, mm-hmm. and I can maintain that, let's say, for at least 30 days, mm-hmm. I'm going to be, I have a much higher chance of sustaining that for the next 30 days, for the next But we do have to get into a routine. We have to have a routine, and what I go back to the word intentional. We have to make a choice that we're intentionally going to engage in something. So one of the things is wellness and self-care, right? In terms of resiliency, wellness and self-care. When COVID struck. And there's all that rain and whatnot. I like to cycle. I mountain bike, I road bike, and then I also go to the gym. Well, all of a sudden, with the bad weather, couldn't cycle. Yeah. And then all of a sudden they closed the gym. So I'm like, well, a person could go, all right, well, I guess I can't. No, there's always a way. There's always a way because it's replacing, okay, so I can't do this, but I can replace that. I can change my routine. I can keep the routine, but yeah. do something different. So I've been doing P90X3 with my wife at home, and that's actually awesome because I get to work out with her. And it's really healthy. But it's taking something I know is life-giving, has to do with wellness, and keeping that routine. I know that if I don't intentionally make that choice, that the chances of that routine breaking down are greater. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So take that same thing and apply it in a number of different areas.
Why would you get into a routine in that 30 days? Why is that 30 days? Why does it feel hard and uncomfortable, especially when you first start?
Change is hard. Mm-hmm. Doing something different can be challenging.
Yeah. And how do you, if you want to have success getting through those 30 days, is it good to find a mentor, someone to support you through that process?
Yes.
Like pulling teeth, Doug. Like pulling teeth. Why is it important?
I want to get a chance to, to say something, No, I think, like the example, for me, again, everyone's a bit different. But I would say in general, you stand a better chance of success if you are doing it with someone else or some others, a group. So, for example, in the biking group, there's a ton of people in the biking group, but there's some that on Messenger they start up a workout of the day, okay, and this friend of ours, she puts out the workout of the day, and that's just one example of okay, so. Everyone on that messenger list gets that. And then we see people make comments or whatnot, or that was a pain in the ass.
Yeah, thanks.
It's like, I barely got through this. but it goes back to the connecting too, yeah. Right? So this is on a lot of these things in resilience, you can kill more, multiple birds with one stone, so to speak. You're connecting with others. You're doing something that provides wellness, health, physical health, making a difference. And if you get into that routine, that can, some of it is accountability. If you know that, so-and-so is going to show up at 8 in the morning to go on a ride, and you said yes to them, you're much more likely to go. If you just go, I plan to get up in the morning, I'm going to go on a hike, or I know you, I've seen you run, hike, whatever. If you have some level of accountability, or someone that's going, hey, how was the thus and such today? And, oh, I didn't go.
It's good peer pressure, right?
Yeah, I mean, I would see that as, you can put it under category of peer pressure. I look at that as healthy connectedness.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and like you mentioned, when you're in that Facebook group, that messenger, and there's a workout every day, and you go, man, they're doing a good job, I want to be part of that, that's positive motivation. Can we do more of that to make ourselves part of those groups? Those groups are usually open groups. How do I make myself accountable? How do I do this? I have a buddy of mine, Evan Russo. I try to post about 3 times a week his videos. He has a daily routine, his workout routine with his mom and dad. He puts it live on Facebook, on Instagram. And that's his thing. So why not share that? So I don't have to do it every day. I do my own workouts. Someone can do at home on their dining room floor, the kitchen floor, a good workout that takes about 10 feet.
Something that you just brought up, I think is essential for all of us to hear, and that is, all right, so the gym is closed, so I can't go to my favorite elliptical. I can't. We can either focus on what we can't do, going back to that, or we can focus on what we can do, mm-hmm. Right? So it's raining outside. It's this, the gym is closed. What can I do? So I do P90X3. A number of those workouts require dumbbells and pull up bar and all that stuff. And so someone might go, well, I can't do it because I don't have all that equipment. It's like, okay, guess what? There are workouts that 100% don't use equipment and can kick your butt.
Mm-hmm. Just your own body weight.
Yes, your own body weight, all kinds of body weight exercises. So I go back to the encouragement of, all right, so you don't have that equipment, but what can you do?
It's a mindset, correct? It's how you think about the problem, not I'm going to shut down because that's it. I'm giving, the day's over. I'm done. Mm-hmm. One thing's gonna shut me all down. Mm-hmm. Even if you don't have weights at home, can you use water bottles? Can you use cans of soup? Can you use something? Can you MacGyver it to make it possible to complete what you want to complete?
Yeah.
And at home, right now, I've lost the gym. I can't bench press 100-pound dumbbells. I can't squat 500 pounds. So I have my wife's 5-pound pink weights that I use every day. I do, I think, 100. I can't count that, but maybe at least 50 of each exercise just to get a workout in.
Yeah.
So I have decent shoulders, not huge shoulders, but these decent shoulders to show on all these videos.
There's so much you can do with your own body weight. And if it was left up to me to be, I'm not that creative with, like, okay, what's the, I don't own stock in beachbody.com, but beachbody.com are the makers of P90X and some other workouts. And I learned about that because a bunch of years ago, I did the first P90X, and I told the family, okay, we're going to do P90X. We're going to be active.
That's it.
We don't want to do that. They come up with an alternative, but we will all do something. So my lovely wife and daughter, they did it for a bit and they're like, you know, we don't like this guy, Tony.
Yeah.
Kind of, you know, whatever. So they went to beachbody.com and got a workout from a gal, Shalene. Again, I'm not advertising for them.
Yeah.
And I got to tell you, they got into it. They had a blast. And then my son, he said, yeah, I'm not interested in that, but he got into cross country. Mm-hmm. It doesn't matter. It's doing something, whatever floats your boat, but being active and challenging your physical body. Going back to resilience, that makes all the difference in the world in terms of wellness. Right now, a lot of us have higher levels of stress. It is well known, well documented in research that if you do cardiovascular exercise, that helps to flush the body of the glucocorticoids that build up the stress response chemicals in the body that build up because of stress. So if we can each day flush our body of those chemicals, then in essence, that will help us sleep, that will help with mood, better mood regulation, etc. Because all of those tie in. We're one whole person. We're not, you know, mind over here, body over here. We're one whole person. So if we can do these things, then it makes all the difference in the world.
I think a lot of it is when you're trying to correlate stress with health overall, if our body's healthier, our stress level drops, correct?
Yeah. No. Yeah. Well, it's more complicated than that, but as a simple equation, if we are doing wellness activities, mm-hmm. if we are connecting with others, so if you look at some other research, loneliness is really detrimental to one's health.
Yeah. Okay. Self-isolation.
Well, and so when I first heard what we're having to do mm-hmm. because of COVID-19, my immediate thought was, oh, crap. and I totally get it. This isn't a commentary on, of course, we need to take extreme measures. So we had to social distance. We had to socially isolate, right? Mm-hmm. And within there, that reduces touch, that reduces the potential for connection with others. And you're taking away people's ability to have a purposeful life. i.e. a job.
Yeah.
That is a recipe for disaster in terms of mental health. Again,
well, that would be for job security too, right? For you.
No, I don't look at it that way. I hate public speaking and get anxious and all that, but as soon as you invited me and I got another invitation for speaking, I'm like, you know what? There's hurting people out there. I've got to do this. I got to get over my own anxiety about, you know.
I've asked you like for 5 years now to go.
I finally acquiesced.
COVID-19, the first that happened. Thanks, COVID. that's one thing. You know, when I heard about that, you said with self-isolation comes not only do we not move as much, we don't communicate with other people as much. You said physical touch isn't there. The routine of going to work, talking to Johnny, talking to Carol every day, see how their weekend went, talking to patients every day too. At that point, you've dropped your wellness that would help you with wellness maybe 50%. Then how do you now you're filling that wellness with that 50% of your chips with maybe something negative that's dropping your whole 100% of your 24 hours a day into a spiral of how to get out of here.
People, one of the biggest things is this notion of uncertainty. Mm-hmm. So you've replaced what feels like more, you know, okay, this is my schedule. I feel like I have some control over my life. Mm-hmm. I have a routine. I have these disciplines that are life-giving, these connections that are life-giving. All of a sudden, you're being told, no, 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 no. You can't do this. You can't do this. You can't do this. And that's why one of the first, hopefully the listeners will go and go to Samaritan Counseling Center Upland, our website, and because we immediately, I'm not big on newsletters, but because of COVID-19, we've stepped up our newsletters because these are essential pieces of information that are life-giving for people. And so one of the first newsletters I put out was something where, okay, this is, think about what you can do. Mm-hmm. What can you do in this situation that is life-giving? Okay, so you can't do this, but then what can you do? I know I'm repeating myself.
But there were every week, correct? Newsletter every week. Your newsletter was every week, correct?
No. I mean, sometimes I might do, we might, in the past, maybe one newsletter a year.
I started getting to my email box probably about right when things started going crazy.
In the last 2 months, I think we've done, five. So it's, and it's covered everything from, you're not alone. There, some mental health research, how to connect and love amidst, COVID-19. We have a newsletter on resilience. That's one of the reasons I'm pushing resilience so much, because we can actually, if we can employ resilience engendering behaviors, we can come out of this stronger as individuals, as families, as communities, as a nation.
Wow. That's good. You should be on TV.
Isn't this TV?
Kind of, sort of. and you're thinking of not only now, but say 6 months from now, a year from now. So if something else comes back, God forbid, a second wave, now we're ready for that wave. Now I know how to deal with that. I have a patient who's a therapist also, and she was saying people that already have anxiety or depression, they're actually doing better because they already have coping skills. Someone that has never seen a therapist or doesn't understand how therapy works, they're going in, now they're anxious, now because now that this is new for them. They don't have any coping skills. I think we're going to learn our own personal coping skills we can do to stay well, stay resilient, and get back to maybe a indirect physical social connection with people to make sure we're ready for the next thing that happens, for either our personal lives or internationally, like a pandemic again.
We grow through challenge. I mentioned that before. Mm-hmm. So, when we go back to lifting weights, we are actually like breaking down the muscle tissue. We are challenging the muscle tissue, and that's not a pleasant process.
Uncomfortable and painful.
Yeah, but the end result is that we're stronger, and if we are stronger, then we're also more resilient. If that muscle is challenged, it has more reserve to be able to function. So apply that to as humans, we're very complex. And I think I really liked what you had to say. You take a typical person that was otherwise functioning okay, and you've added stressors and yet taken away those resources. So in an otherwise fine functioning individual, you've now created symptoms of depression, anxiety, whatever. And one of the things I would say is it, don't wait for it to get really bad before you get help. That's what the 25% that didn't do so, that's what they do. They avoid, they don't get help, they don't share, they don't process, they isolate. So go talk with it. Doesn't mean that you have to immediately go see a therapist, but talk with someone. And if the social support that you do have and the purposeful things that you do, if it still seems like there's still a bit of stuckness, then go sooner than later and talk with a therapist. And it doesn't have to go, you don't have to see the therapist forever.
Yeah.
We're not, you know, but helping them, sometimes we all need a little bit of help through some tough situations, right? If you look at the prevalence of mental health issues, like what I'm talking about, at any one point in time, that's easily 20-25% of the population. Mm-hmm. So if you think about that, all right, if about 25% of the population has some type of mental health issues, something that is keeping them from thriving in life, and they can get help, then through that process they can get stronger. So when you ask about, well, 6 months from now, well, yes, exactly. If we intentionally choose life-giving, resilience engendering behaviors right now, and we grow, we build that, then yeah, 6 months from now, we're going to be a lot stronger.
Well, and same thing, building strength, just physical strength. If I'm have a problem doing weights, for example, and I go into a gym and don't, and I know I'm okay, but I'm not strong where I want to get to. If I hire a trainer or work with a trainer, even someone that is in a better shape than me, at that point, I have a better chance successfully getting to a healthier physical state with less chance of injury, less risk of doing the wrong thing in a shorter period of time. Who wouldn't want that?
Yeah. And one of the things that you brought up earlier, I'm going to connect it, and that is if a person is emotionally acting out, and typically it happens with the people around us, oftentimes they don't know what the underlying issue is.
Okay.
That is where someone who is skilled at what in that arena makes all the difference in the world. Mm. So since you brought up the physical, I had shoulder surgery. I was strong. I could do a gazillion pull-ups, push-ups, all kinds of stuff. I had shoulder surgery. It took away. Yeah. Took away the muscle mass, strength, and whatnot. And so I go back to, and I'm looking at what's happening.
Yeah.
I'm getting more and more discouraged. I can't do this. I can't do this. I'm like, oh my gosh, what can I do? So I did what I could do. It was very limited. I go into the gym. I had basically this arm was completely immobilized. And people look at me going, this guy's going to fall right on his. You know, and I almost did a couple times trying to get on the elliptical with one arm. If you don't balance yourself, I almost fell off the spin bike too. It was, you know, where am I going with this?
Well, you adapted to it. You were able to do something, but maybe not completely, but something.
I was doing something, but I had to rely on guidance as to what I could do, and then as I went through the process of rehabbing my shoulder, I had to go to people who knew what the heck they were doing. Because if it was left up to me, I'd be going, okay, well, here's the weights I used to lift. And
starting over.
Yeah. Oh, dude, you just have to do the surgery all over again. No, I had to go to people that knew what the heck they were doing and how to guide me. And it was a humbling experience. I here in my, you know, one of the places I did rehab was the heated pool at Casa Colina. And I'm doing simple things that, you know, it's like, really, this is all I can do right now.
Yeah.
And they're like, yep. If you want to not damage what was done in surgery and you want to make progression, this is how you have to do it. So it was a humbling process, but they knew what the heck they were doing, and I had to humble myself to follow that regimen. So in a similar fashion, there's a lot of things that we're not aware of.
We just don't know. We're naive. So once you've gone through something like that, why would you know, why would you want to know how to rehab a shoulder on your own unless it personally affects you? So by trusting someone like you did and humble and trust a professional you may not know personally, at that point, okay, I want to be here in 6 months. I'm focused on that. This may suck right now. This may not feel like I'm doing enough. But if they tell me I can get there in 6 months or whatever time frame it's going to be, let me trust them to get there. Versus on my own, like you said, you might tweak it again. You might need another surgery. Your arm might fall off. Who knows?
Yeah. Well, one of the things it reminds me of is the Stockdale paradox. Okay. And have you ever heard of?
No, I don't hear much.
Well, it was popularized in Jim Collins' "Good to Great." It's a leadership book.
Okay.
The Stockdale paradox, if I'm remembering correctly, is a prisoner of war. And the bottom line is the folks that fared the best were ones that were able to take in the stark reality of the situation and yet never lose hope. Okay. As soon as, why am I mentioning this? In COVID-19, we've had these dates. Okay, so we just have to hang in there and just, you know, until April 15th, right? And then everything's going to open up again and everything's
going back to normal.
We're all good. And so the folks that hung their hat on that and were married to that, they did not fare well.
No.
Because if what we're doing is we're holding our breath until this date and all of a sudden magically everything's going to be better, that's not dealing with reality. So that's holding on to something that there's a good chance we don't have any control over.
Yeah.
So the folks that fared best are ones that there's a balance between, you know, the reality, the tough truths of the situation and yet optimism. So going back to the you know, I know you've gone through some health issues and won't bring it up, but for me it was okay, the stark reality is I don't have a functioning arm.
Mm-hmm.
My shoulder and my strength as I knew it is no longer. That's the tough reality. If I go to the gym right now, I cannot lift that weight right there. I used to be able to lift 10 times that amount of weight, and I can't even lift that safely. That's the stark reality. And yet the hope is balanced with hope. I know that if I choose to go through this process, there is hope. There is hope. I know I can pull through this. I know that I will be, you know, in the end, I will be stronger. COVID-19, if we're married to, okay, we have to have this. We had, you know, it's this day. We have to deal with a new reality. We have to be flexible enough to go, okay, the world as we know it has changed. We got to deal with that. We got to deal with that stark reality. So I know I'm bullish on the future. I know we will get through this. Right now, there's some things that really suck.
Yeah.
So going back to your question about the person that lost their job, what can I do right now? It sucks. I have to deal with the stark reality that I don't have. Okay, but what can I do? And can I maintain hope that if I make choices right now, that will get me, you know, step by step, I believe that I will be employed. I believe that we will all make it through this. That it's that type of, there's a balance there.
And when you think about now that I'm hopeful, how do I get there and build a routine, habits, wellness in my life and purpose? So at that point, even 2, 3, 4 months, because now I know mentally and physically I can handle the pressure of what's going on now. If I can handle it now, If things can't get really a lot worse, maybe I can handle that too. But if they get better, then I'll be in a better state no matter what. This, my body, my mind will be where it should be, and it can handle more stress if need be, because now I have this routine, these coping skills, make my mindset get through and find out how to get through.
You bring up an excellent point, and that is, you know, one thing that we can do, and this isn't dwelling on the past. This is going, okay, when have I been in a tough situation before in my life? And what did I do and how did I make it through? Mm. So I've been through tough situations. Okay. Was I able to make it through? What worked? I love to ask that. Okay, well, what worked in the situation?
Yeah.
So that's part of the reason why I say we're going to get through this, and we stand the we have the opportunity to get stronger through this process. Mm-hmm. And if nothing else, we stand the opportunity to learn how the heck to use Zoom.
Yeah.
or technology. I mean, when you said we're going to use this, you know, blah blah blah. I'm like, Tony, I've never heard of this thing. What the heck is it?
That's what you test to make sure you can figure it out.
You know, right? Okay, so we're being challenged to do things in a different way. We're learning new things.
But can that new thing be exciting and fun, or does it have to be stressful and, if you want to call it, disappointing? Like, dang it, I need new thing. I love learning things every day. But it takes a certain mentality, like you said, the ignition to go, this is going to be fun for me, exciting, not boring and stressful.
You bring up that it's an interesting conundrum. How we think about things makes all the difference in the world. How we choose to think about things can make the difference between something being exhilarating or terrifying.
Yeah, I like both.
Well, yeah, I probably shouldn't disclose too much, but, you know, I do some crazy things. I took a friend, a psychiatrist, a number of years ago. So enough distance has been done. So, you know, anyway, a number of years ago on a trail in the Angeles National Forest, mountain biking. And we both love mountain biking. And this is a big trail going through the mountains and whatnot. And part of it goes along the edge of a cliff, and it's probably about, I don't know, 800,000 foot drop. But so the trail goes along that edge, and the vista is amazing. So at one point, you know, there's like this little curve, and I pause. I'm going, so-and-so, isn't this awesome? I mean, this is beautiful up here. To which he replied, this is terrifying. What are you? So, given the same exact set of stressors, the same exact situation, one person can look at it as exhilarating, and another person can see it as absolutely terrifying. I learned something that day. This person's not big on what we call exposure. Okay. Note to self.
You can't really give people a question every time you do something. Hey, do you like this? Are you scared of this? Before we go on our journey, you know?
Well, and leave it to me. Just because someone's scared of something, that doesn't mean it should be avoided. All right. So. Right. Yeah. I look at it as, if a person knows what they're, you need to operate within your capacity, operate within your skill set. And I knew I could follow that trail and not fall off the edge. And honestly, he was a really good mountain biker too. So there was no doubt in my mind that he could do it. Yeah. But how we think about it makes all the difference in the world. So you asked about stress. Do we have to be happy? Well, you know, honestly, there's a lot of stuff that I have not been happy about in this COVID-19.
Yeah.
It's been stressful. My response isn't, oh, I'm all excited. No, yeah. It's like, gosh, freaking darn it. I'm going to do this if I need to. As I've gone through the process, one of the things I've challenged myself to do, and I've challenged my staff to do, is let's look at the silver linings. Mm-hmm. because there are silver linings. So that's one point. I won't develop that right now, but I want to go back to your stress comment. For growth, it requires stress.
Yep.
It does. So what we make of it makes, that's where the difference is.
Yep.
You know, getting those degrees that I had, that was not easy. That was stressful. I'm a better person. I have a better ability to operate my profession because of it. But it was not easy. I wasn't like all giddy and happy.
Yeah, so I love to think of 8 hours a day and then 8 hours at night to study for this test, you know? No.
You know, some of my buddies, you know, that already have jobs and what, and they got they have these nice cars and this and that, and I'm going for advanced degrees and working my tail off, staying up, you know, in the library, and it's like, wow, this is really
yay.
I'm thankful. I had to grow, you know, I grew through that. So my point in what you brought up in terms of stress is stress. Mm-hmm. Now, if we have so much stress that it feels overwhelming, then that can be counterproductive. But we all need at least a certain amount of stress to get put some fire under our butt, so to speak, to get us up to go, okay. So like, you know, when you said being on your Crooked Spine show, it's like, uh-oh. Perhaps I will review some of the newsletters that were.
and for me, it took a while to do that and get into. I've done videos since 2011. And for me, it took a while for the first couple to go, this is just, I need to polish myself. But it's like learning how to ride a bike, right? It's something where you do it over time. At that point, it becomes less stressful.
Yeah.
Once you went on that trail and go, okay, this is a trail I'm going to go through. It has an area where it is pretty close to the edge. But now I've done a couple of times to know where that area is. I'm not anxious about it anymore. Now I know mentally and physically I can get through that.
Yeah.
You have to go through something like that to, like you said, to grow and realize that stress may change over time based on how many times you experience that stress.
Exactly. You said it beautifully. And the thing I would encourage or add to that is to lean into it.
Mm, okay. Good.
If we avoid it, then we avoid the opportunity for growth.
Yeah.
If we lean into it and we say, okay, now I'm not saying do something crazy, but
yeah, some disclosure here, yeah.
What's that?
Rest and disclosure. You don't want to go wrestle a bear or something, you know? That'd be dumb.
You dumb?
If you want to, you can. I'll sign a life insurance policy before you go.
It's lean into it and be willing to be challenged. Mm-hmm. That's how we grow. I'm bullish about us coming out the other, you know, and it's not like a date. There's not a date. There isn't a specific, this is a day by day thing. So when you ask the question 6 months from now, well, what we do today helps prepare us for 6 months from now. What we do tomorrow helps prepare. So it's not like all of a sudden we've achieved it and then, oh, okay, we're good. This is a day-by-day process, a moment-by-moment process, I would say, because how we choose to think about something in that moment makes the difference of what neurochemicals are released. If we focus on the positive, if we strive for, you know, gratitude, We hear about that. There's so many things that we have to be thankful for. If we could practice gratitude, and if we can practice showing thankfulness, appreciation towards others, makes all the difference. We get the positive chemicals flowing through our bodies and brains, and we could be a blessing to others, right? Mm-hmm.
And going from that too, the chemical response in your body, what I've learned and read, is when you do that enough to where you focus on gratitude, helping people, and good stressors, your body gravitates toward that on a daily basis versus the negative side, I can't do it or anxious about this. So your body learns what's going to help it grow and stay healthy and resilient versus being stuck in an absurd situation where you can't grow or get healthy.
I think part of what you're referring to are patterns and approaches in life.
Yeah.
I do want to, if I was someone listening to this part, I might say, yeah, but it's easier said than done. Yeah, but what right now I'm you know, with COVID-19, I'm struggling. And to which I would say, yeah, we are all struggling to one extent or another. So in one sense, it helps to know we're all in this together. It helps to know that all of us have been affected to one extent or another. So if the person listening to you go, well, that's nice, Dr. Tony, but you know, I've had this crap, you know, all these stressors, all these things that have happened to me. I got 5 kids at home that I'm trying to do distance learning with.
Yeah.
I'm not making this stuff up. The client this just heard 5 kids, different ages.
Yeah, that's just sounds painful.
What's that?
That sounds painful. Yeah.
Yeah, distance learning and all the typical house chores and this and that and the other thing. I'm having a hard time. I'm having a hard time doing that positive thinking that you're talking about. So part of it is practicing understanding and self-care, but practicing patience for oneself. The things I want to do, maybe I can't do all those right now because of this challenging situation. I go back to the shoulder surgery. I'm used to being very independent, doing everything. I get this arm. It's attached. It's completely and utterly useless. I'm in constant pain. I cannot.
Yeah.
And you'd be surprised at how many things. I'm not going to get into graphic detail, but it makes very basic activities of life challenging with one hand.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
I mean, try putting your socks on with one hand and not being able to move this.
Yeah. And you become more dependent versus independent. So now your whole mentality is I have to ask for help all the time.
Well, so it's a mental, what I'm talking about is that mental shift of, yeah, some of it is asking for help and some of it is going, okay, the expectations I have,
mm-hmm.
I need to lower them. All these shoulds, I need to be careful of shoulds because I'm not going to be able to achieve some of the things that I'm used to doing. So I have to moderate that. Yeah. And that can be tough for some people that are pretty driven.
But it's a part of growth too, is adapting, I think, to what's around you. I mean, it's something to where by growing and learning those points called coping skills or routine habits, can we slowly get from wherever we are, take one step forward and one step forward and one step forward to where now, okay, these 3 steps work for me. Wow, now I have the hope I can do more and be more effective, more productive, and healthier mentally and physically. Can we start just at a small amount and build up over time? As you had mentioned, my shoulds are up here, my expectations are up here. I'm going to keep them here just for today. I'm going to do this. If I get through this, maybe I'll add something tomorrow or maybe 2 days from now versus saying I have to be on track every day, every day, every day. Can I slow it down and go, I'm good at this pace? You go a little bit faster when I'm ready. When I'm ready, there is no time frame based on Johnny or Carol or someone on TV.
Yeah. You said it beautifully. It goes back to what can we do? Now, we can't do everything all at once.
No.
But if we have, I can, whether it's a client, you, a friend, colleague, one of the chamber members, I can go through a list of things that are guaranteed to be helpful. I can, there's not that many guarantees in life, but I can guarantee these things right here will build resilience, right?
Yeah.
It doesn't mean doing them all right now. Because then we become overloaded and we're like, it becomes another, like, okay.
Never mind, Dr. Doug, I'm out.
Yeah, it becomes an impossible task. So it goes back to a simple question of, okay, well, what can I do? What can I do right now? Being intentional about, okay, so here's these wonderful things that Dr. Doug just rattled off. Okay, yeah. I will turn it back and go, which one, but, you know, let's say I'm working with a client. And they're buying in. They're going, gosh, I want to do that. This is what it would look like in my life. I say, between now and the next time we meet, what can you do? What do you want to commit to doing between now and then? So we go through, because these are all great. Let's not talk about it theoretically.
No.
Let's talk about, okay, tomorrow, what does that look like?
Yeah.
The next day, what does that look like? Especially if we're feeling overwhelmed, we have a lot of stress, it's hard to think clearly. Sometimes it's stepping back and being, taking a deep breath, pausing and going, okay, I can't do all of these things all at once. I can't.
Yep.
No human can. I can do this, you know, this one today. I can for you know, 30 minutes. I can do this tomorrow. It's kind of like food and sleep. Yep. I think I'm gonna eat all the food I need to do right now today for the next week. It doesn't work that way.
No.
I'm gonna sleep tonight, and that should last me. You know, I figure a couple of weeks. That way, I can get more stuff. That's a recipe for really that you can get, you can take a normal person, a typical functioning person, and make them psychotic by depriving them of sleep. Mm. You can.
Sure.
So it's establishing those routines, looking at what you can do and taking it one step at a time. And I have to be patient with myself, because I want to have it already done. I want to, you know, it's like, hold on. Right now, because of COVID-19, I got to do these extra steps. And that's just the way it is right now.
You mentioned, too, self-patience. Whatever I want to do, can I be self-patient with myself to give myself time to do these things, to give myself, my body and mind, time to become part of me versus jumping, then getting nothing done.
Yeah.
No. Wrap it up for me, Dr. Doug. Wrap up our talk today.
Wrap up?
Mm-hmm. I got to go take a nap. I'm done. What I like about your talk so far today, and we'll do another show down the line post-COVID, is resilience. Is when we focus on that, we can start expanding out different circles of, how do we build a routine? How do we find ways, the one thing today, maybe one thing tomorrow, to start looking at our life around us, or people around us, and get into, how do I make this simple? How do I make this doable? And give myself time, 30 days plus, even longer than that, to get into a physical and mental health state and adapt to the physical around me.
Definitely, let's do it. If it's helpful, one of the things I could do is reflect on a few things that I think are maybe our good takeaways.
Good.
Would that work for you?
Yep, I'm good.
So right now we're in an extraordinary situation. There's a lot of loss, there's a lot of stress. Mm-hmm. And so we can all identify that with that work. We're all in this together. I love the to tell folks that, hey, we're in this together and we will make it through. So that Stockdale paradox of deal with the harsh reality of the situation and never give up hope. Never give up hope. It's that optimistic thinking. Good. What can we do to engender, to build resilience? Our brains need structure in order to function well. So establishing the new structure and the new routine. Okay, so I can't go to the gym. All right, well, what can I do? I can do this. There's all kinds of online workouts, and I can do that. And I'm going to choose to do that in this 45-minute window of my day. So that's just, that's an example. Practice self-understanding and patience. We were just talking about that. You've heard me say a lot on hope and healthy thinking, right? Yep. Hope and healthy thinking. Think about, the gratitudes and what are the silver linings? Those are things that we can grab hold of and that can give us hope and strength. What is our purpose right now? Having a purpose, even if we're not working, maybe we can help others.
Yeah.
Right. Mm-hmm. And then connecting some of that hope, healthy thinking, and what can we do in this situation with the Serenity Prayer? You don't know the Serenity Prayer, you can look it up. It's well known. It's really been made manifest in the recovery circles. It is phenomenal, but I would say it's great for all of us. We talked a lot about this connect with as well as supporting others. The social isolation does not mean loneliness. Loneliness is deadly. Yeah. Connecting with others, being part of a group, and that can serve multiple functions. And then another thing I'm just really big on is wellness and self-care. So the exercise, the eating healthy, getting your sleep, all those things are powerful. One of the silver linings that some of my clients have shared is they have actually gotten closer as a family.
Yeah.
Family time, daddy and child connecting time. Sometimes the father's off going doing this and that at work, which is totally important. But all of a sudden now there's maybe a little bit more time. That's a silver lining. That's a beautiful thing. Is there stress? Of course there's stress. But there's always, we can look at the silver linings. One of the greatest challenges is uncertainty. And so being able to be, to let go of trying to control, there's a lot of things that we can't control. So going back to, okay, what can I do? And yet having that hope for, as we make progress, getting stronger towards the future. So those are a few thoughts I might leave you with. Don't be part of the 25% that have faced a trauma and then avoided. So don't do the avoiding. Don't do the turning to a variety of unhealthy coping mechanisms.
Okay.
Those we all know. And be willing to ask for help. Be willing to talk with someone. And sometimes that it means talking with a therapist. And Samaritan Counseling Center, we got some great therapists, master's and doctoral level therapists that have specialties from marriage, relationship issues, children. We have individuals, therapists that specialize in working with children. And the usual anxiety, depression, all kinds of different challenges. Don't wait until, it's not bad enough for me to go get help.
It's easier to become aware and fix something when things are not bad enough, correct?
Well, sometimes as humans, we go, it's not bad enough. My car is not broken down on the side of the road, so I don't need to change the oil.
Yeah, the lights are on, but this car's still working. There's still little hazard lights on my dashboard.
It's still going. It's still going. So, right. You know, I mean, how bad could it be, right?
Yeah.
So sometimes it's maintenance. Sometimes it's beneficial for therapy can be beneficial for our growth so that we can thrive as opposed to just survive.
Yeah.
There's a huge difference between surviving versus thriving.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
That's it. Yeah.
Dr. Tony, thank you so much for this opportunity. I really mean it that there's folks that if this can help them in any way, shape, or form, then that brings me joy. That encourages me because I hear it every day, people that are struggling. And if we can, by you doing this, you're helping a lot of people. And I really appreciate it. I hope that that others give you kudos for doing that.
And because you know your stuff and you're able to verbalize it very well, it made the show very easy. I didn't have to do anything. I just sat here and nodded my head the whole time, you know? But we talked a little about last week is you're going to start doing more shows and more shows and more shows because now you feel comfortable. We kind of broke the ice with this show, I think. So people invite you more to go, hey, what does Dr. Doug think? And not only will it, in my sense, help my audience, my patients even too, that watch a show and then hear it again on my podcast down the line versus the video, it'll help people overall hear your word and your message about your center, Samaritan Counseling Center, as a way to get help. People just don't know. And if they don't know what to do, they're going to go to the vices sometimes.
Yeah.
And that may help temporarily, but long-term what they're doing to their body and their mind. But you saying and doing like you did today allowed people to hear what they can do because they're ready for it.
Yeah.
Now's the time for them to listen.
Yeah.
Dr. Doug, thank you. You did phenomenal. I'm glad you weren't nervous this time. You're good. And you'll do great in the future.
Who says I wasn't nervous, man?
You took a chill pill before you came on. I understand.
No. You make it easy. And I'm serious. I really appreciate what you do, who you are, what you're about, and creating this platform for this type of help and information.
Good. Thanks, Dr. Doug. I'll see you guys soon. Again, the show notes, what I'm going to do is put all your information on so we can contact you directly and hopefully get more emails out there too. So more and more information people have when they're ready. They'll watch, they'll listen, they'll read, and hear everything.
Awesome.
Thank you, sir. Have a good day.
You too. Take care.
Hope this talks helps you with Dr. Doug to understand that you can get through this. We all can get through this, but it's going to take some perception of what reality is now, and how we can change our own selves and help other people around us to go through this stress and grow through this stress so overall our bodies can get healthier and stay resilient for a long period of time, no matter how long it takes to get through this COVID-19 crisis. All right, so the show notes has the highlights of this talk. Go to there along with Dr. Doug and Samaritan Counseling Center's information. Talk to them, see if they can help you even with just normal life stuff. Not enjoy the week, enjoy the weekend. We'll all do this together, okay? Have a great day.